Okay, so hi, and thank you for joining us for this quick conversation. I'm really excited about this one, as I have been all of them so far, to be honest, because we're going to have a look at how we can use speech selection on the iPad to do proofreading and proof listening. Before we do that, I want to introduce you to my good friend, Kristine. In fact, Kristine, could you introduce yourself?
Yes, I am Jacob's good friend, Kristine, and I am based in Norway, where I work as a teacher. I know Jacob because we are fellow ADEs. Yeah, that's briefly about me. I'm a teacher.
As a teacher, we know about using iPad effectively in the classroom, and we know about the vast array of accessibility tools that are built in the iPad to support every learner. And this series of videos is all about picking a tool that you use in your situation, in your class, and diving in a little bit to how it's used and how it supports your learners. So I mentioned briefly about speech selection. Could you briefly describe how you use that in your classroom?
Well, what I do with it most of the time is whenever we write texts, especially texts that are to be handed in, I always really appreciate if students take the time to proofread them. And they always insist that they have proofread them. They very rarely actually have. And so I ask, have you proof listened to it? And they're like, what is that? How can I? Just mark your text, have the iPad read it to you, and then you can hear if something is a bit strange. If something sounds a bit strange, go in the text, have a look, because that's probably a spelling mistake. And they're like, oh, yeah, they can do that, no problem. So that's how I use it the most. I also use it for my students who are dyslexic. I always encourage them to listen to things rather than spending all their time trying to decipher and reading it. Not that they shouldn't practice, but it makes their life a lot easier.
Absolutely. I think I'm as guilty as any of your students to not proofreading things that I've written. And I think when I do pretend to proofread it, I just gloss over things so quickly because you feel like you've written it so you know what it's going to say. So actually having a tool that can enhance that experience sounds really valuable. Well, before we get too far into this conversation, let's have a quick look at how people watching can enable this on their device and a quick look at how it works. And then we'll come back and talk about it more in the classroom. To enable this feature, we're going to jump into the Settings app. And then on the left-hand side, we're going to find Accessibility. From here, you'll find Spoken Content, and tapping on there brings up the option we need. All you really need to do is enable the Speak Selection toggle at the very top of this screen, and that will add that speech option to the floating toolbar whenever you highlight text. But before we test it out, we can actually make a couple more changes here as well. So you can see here we have the option to highlight content. That means when it's being read aloud to you, it will highlight that part of the screen. You can tap onto here and select what colour you want, and whether or not you wanted to highlight words or whole sentences. But the other option, which I find really useful, is changing the voice. When I tap onto Voices, I can then choose exactly which voice I want to read my content. This can be a different voice for different languages as well, and iPadOS will automatically detect which one to use. I'm going to tap onto the Siri voice, and then from here I can choose one of the four UK English Siri voices.
Hi, I'm Siri.
Hi, I'm Siri.
Yep, I like that one, I think, so I'm going to select this option. And now, all I need to do to test this is to jump into an app that's got some text. So for me, I'm going to jump into the Pages app, and I've got a document on screen here. All I'm going to do is tap and hold to highlight the first couple of sentences in this paragraph, and now on that floating toolbar, I can press Speak.
At the moment, there are empty placeholders for each team member on every core value page. It would be fantastic if you could all fill these in this week so we...
And just like that, Siri's reading it out loud to me. Okay, so now you've seen just how easy it is to enable this. Let's dig a little bit more into how you use it in your classroom. You mentioned using it for proofreading. What impact does that have on your learners in terms of what they're doing in their class?
Well, I think that just the effort in trying to spell things right, like the bar becomes a lot lower. Most people, or not most people, I have students who also write correctly, but it just sort of, it's too much of a hassle for them to bother to do it. So they just sort of accept having done mediocre work that could have been better with a final touch. And I feel like it lowers the bar for everyone to do that final touch, which just sort of, for me, as the person who reads a lot of student work, it's just a much better experience. And that's kind of my argument with the students as well. I read 120 of your texts, and it makes me happy when they are spelled correctly. Try and make me happy.
So it doesn't just benefit your students, it benefits you and your well-being
Yes.
as well.
And also in my feedback to my students, I feel like, you know, remember to spell this word correctly. That's not a feedback of any kind of value, but giving them a tool to help them spell things correctly, that's better.
So it sounds like it's a tool your students are very familiar with. Do they use it unprompted now? Do you quite often find them highlighting sentences and listening back? Or is it normally when you suggest that they do it again?
It's still normally when I suggest that they do it. Like, they're done. Can I hand it in? I'm like, have you proofread? Yes. Have you proof-listened? Which I know that they haven't done because they didn't take out their earplugs. So, and yeah, they'll go and they'll do that. They very often use it like when I introduce an assignment, like if they're tired or it's the end of the day, some might prefer to like listen to the task description once more instead of reading it out loud to themselves.
That's interesting. So not just proofread their own work, but actually be able to understand the instructions and that input as well and have that listen to them.
Yeah.
Interesting. You mentioned about using earbuds, and I was kind of thinking earlier, if I had 30 children doing this at once, it would be a nightmare, to be quite frank. I wouldn't be able to hear anything. It would be all over the place. Do all your students have earbuds, and is that something that they're quite used to using?
Not everyone has them, but we have a set that they can loan.
Okay. When I was exploring speech selection to make the little quick tips part of this video, I was interested about the language detection and the different language that can use. Have you had any experience of that aspect of the tool?
Yeah, because we use it both for Norwegian and English, and I know that sometimes they use it for German and French. So the fact that you can alter the language so that the voice being read to you is actually, you know, as similar to a native speaker as you can get, it also helps you, you know, especially when learning a different language, like what is this meant to sound like if it's not a given from the way it's spelled? So that's actually a huge help when learning a second language.
Yeah, it's never going to be quite the same having a Siri voice reading it to you compared to a human, but I guess it gets you 80% of the way there to hearing different pronunciations.
It can also kind of be fun to have the settings be set for Norwegian and have it read an English text.
I imagine that gives an interesting result. I'll have
to
try.
It doesn't sound great, but it's kind of a good example of, you know, why you should make an effort to try and have it sound a bit English when we speak.
Interesting. So this sounds like a tool that you're getting a lot of use from in your class. And we've seen about how it can, you know, transform your teaching because you're able to mark work that has been proof listened to. So for people who are watching this who haven't tried this tool before, or maybe who haven't used it in this way, what advice would you give them in terms of exploring its potential and what it could offer to them and their learners?
I think it's a really good idea to just have a demonstration of it with the students, like in a class, have some kind of a model text, for example, that can be fun to listen to, and just go through the motions, like push here, push here, push here, push here, ta-da! Because it's kind of a very easy way to get them to use it, to introduce it to them. And then, you know, just have you proof listened to this text. Try and do that before you hand it in. So just a quick demonstration, and remember to ask the question when they tell you they're done.
I think that's it. It is such a simple feature to enable and to use. Actually, it doesn't take loads of training. It's just, it becomes another option on that floating context bar. And when it's there, it's usable whenever you want. So we're talking lots about it, but it's such a quick thing. Just getting one, giving it a try, I think is the way to go, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Well, look, thank you so much for your time. It's a quick conversation, so we're going to end it there. But hopefully people that are watching and listening have learned something that they can try on their iPads in their class. Hopefully improve that teaching and learning by using these accessibility features. So Kristine, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.